The circle of life.
It's a mess, that.
Lad, do you know how many direct messages I got saying,
same.
Steve,
don't upload it.
Your voice is amazing. You should. And Simon Cowell actually got in touch and said he wants me on the show next week.
Please.
Yeah.
Full of shit.
Did you like The Lion King as a kid?
No.
You didn't?
Is that make me out to be a wimp or something?
Did you cry when Mufasa died?
No.
You definitely cried when Mufasa died. You're
no
a crier.
Chance. No.
I can see you.
Dave.
Lad, you, I bet you cried at like Legally Blonde 2 or something, didn't you?
What's that?
It's a film.
I don't watch them sort of.
You're things. A crier. And I know you're. I can see you well enough now.
What's it called? It's a chick flick.
I love good chick flick.
Chick, yeah, he's into his
I love
chick.
A good rom-com.
Sunday night.
Rom-com, romantic comedies.
Oh, no, I don't watch nothing like that. Like, it's got to be true story stuff for me.
Documentaries.
Just true story.
Anyway, did you like The Lion King? You must have liked The Lion King.
I know what The Lion King is. I've watched it with our baby in that.
It's a good film, isn't it?
Well, for kids, yeah.
Yeah, you, like...
Yeah, me, grown men don't watch it.
Well, listen, there's the circle of life. That's what this podcast is all about. That's why I'm asking you. Circle of life. Part of The Lion King, wasn't it?
That's next week, lad. What's it called? Who's he called? Hakuna Matata or something. He's on The Lion King, though. He's the only one I can remember, isn't he?
Hakuna Matata's not a character.
What is it?
It's a song. Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase. Well, means no worries.
Isn't that a place?
No, it means no worries, Harry. Hakuna Matata. No wonder you've never heard, but your life is one big worry. Aren't you, big worry wart?
I've got no worries.
Oh, yeah, your back was... A big worry last week.
Last week, mate, my back was killing the crowd getting up to chair.
We finished the podcast and he was in tears nearly. He said, lad, I had to stop myself from crying.
No, I'm punishing myself to be here.
You still just cracked on, didn't you? You know, when I was listening back as well, I could half tell when you were in pain.
I'm still a little bit stiff now.
What, your back?
Yeah.
Just clarification.
Yeah, just my back.
So, it is the circle of life and... We're going to talk about plants, seeds, cuttings, propagation, humidity, and a little bit of the science of young plants as well. So that's what we're into today, Barry.
You had to get the science involved, didn't you?
Let's go.
Could have kept it simple, basic. This is how you do it. But he didn't. Got the science involved.
Don't look so coaty for both. The science show, bitch. You get your little bit at the end. We'll let them all listen to that.
Realist.
Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
All good? Ready to go? Say my voice up a little bit.
Oh God, for everyone watching, the whole family.
Are you ready to go? Are you going to be in the house that I built, in the booth that I built?
I know people tune in every Sunday to listen, but even when business is good, we still manage to do the podcast.
Podcast 164, The Propagator.
Why do you make them rhyme?
That's what I do, isn't it?
Corny that sounds.
The Propagator. Oh. 164. It's for the American listeners. I like making it rhyme. It makes me feel good. It's my little job at the beginning
of
each podcast.
You just do whatever keeps you happy.
Well, don't be such a spoil sport, Barry. We need to talk about early plant development and start talking through actually some of the partner products as well. So this is about propagation. Seedlings, seeds, how to get them to pop, young plants, and basically the vegetative stages of plant growth. What would start our first proper podcast of 2019 at the very beginning, the seeds, the circle of life. So we've got our first partner, CANNA. What products have they got that are relevant to propagation for this week?
You've got CANNA Start with them, haven't you? That's a good product.
It is CANNA Start for babies, for young cuttings, when they've got a root system on.
Yeah.
Important because, you know, if you dilute A and B, a 1 litre A and B, then you're getting all the macronutrients, but you're not getting all the micronutrients because you've diluted it too far. With something like CANNA Start, it's a proper baby feed. So you're getting all the macros and you're getting all the micros in the right amounts as well. So if you do tend to feed with your base nutrients at a diluted rate, you might notice a few deficiencies. So it's good to use a plant food. That's
don't
right
you do it a media as well?
To be honest, yeah, they do Terra seed mix. Yeah. Not something that I've ever used or seen before. No. But I had a little look at it the other week, and apparently it's got really good moisture capacity for holding onto water, which is exactly what seeds need. So if you did want to pot up into just straight soil, then using something like that with a high water content and it'll hold onto the water is going to be the best start for your seeds.
Yeah.
And what else have they got? Rhizotonic. They've got rhizotonic for when your plants have developed, they've got a good root system. You add a little bit of rhizotonic and improve the growth and the power of your roots. AutoPot, they do good propagation units, easy to propagate. It's the biggest propagator on the market, and it comes with copper matics, you can go onto their website and have a look at everything it's got. But it's the biggest propagator with a really high dome, so you can end up keeping your plants in there for a little bit longer than you can do with traditional propagators.
Mm.
And they've also got the humidity domes you can put in the 15-litre pots, which increases humidity and makes you transplant your young plants a lot easier. We have got, what else have we got? SANlight. We've got an LED that's called the Q4W.
Have you heard about this?
They've got two LEDs, Q4W and Q6W. The Q4W is a little bit better, and I mention it on this podcast because it's a much lighter light, if that makes sense, less wattage. And the reason it's good for propagation, and it, along with things like CFLs,
yeah,
other low intensity lights, is that it doesn't have much infrared in the spectrum. So with infrared, the plants transpire a lot more, they lose a lot more water, and when they're young, you don't want them to lose too much water. So an LED, like the SANlight Q4W, would be best for that because you're not going to lose too much water and they're still getting a good spread of spectrum. You've also got can, fan and filters. Now, if you're in early propagation, in my opinion, the best thing to do is just have nothing.
Yeah, have nothing.
But some people just like to have a little bit of air movement. And with things like the RKW, Isomax and
Isomax, but it's only on the lower end ones. That's like a bit of a... You should make them all dimmable, I think.
I agree. I think that it
what is
be
it,
nice.
The 6-inch and the 8-inch come?
Yeah,
you can get a straight powered one, can't you, which is full high power.
Yeah.
Or you can get dimmable with just dimmable in the 6 features. And the 8.
Yeah.
How come they don't do it?
I don't know. Maybe it'll be something technical for like the higher
that,
voltage.
Yeah, that they can't dim the voltage or the amperage or whatever it is that way around.
But they do the smaller outtakes. You can dim them. And that's what you'd want to do with when you're in early propagation. Ideally, don't use anything, and we're going to cover why in the technical parts of the podcast later on. But if you do have to use your fan and filter, get it so that you can dim it down a little bit. And lastly, we've got Revolution Microelectronics. They've got the one that we're going to mention this week is their ceramic metal halide, the 630 watt double ended ceramic metal halide. The reason I mention it on today's podcast with propagation is that it's more of a blue end of the spectrum. Keeps your plants short, stocky. I feel ceramic metal halides and veg give you a better plant growth.
Yeah, because it keeps them small, stocky, and
just prevents
you don't
stretch.
Get that stretch, do you?
Yeah.
So a lot of people struggle when they're doing, but we'll get into that, but people struggle, don't they? They will stretch a lot.
Exactly. And it will give off less infrared heat as well, so less transpiration, which is exactly what you want for young plants. So they're some of the products that you can use from some of the partners. And thank you once again to all the partners for allowing us to do this show. So what is the circle of life?
Once you're born, you start dying. That sounds terrible.
That is such a...
It is, though. That's what they say, don't they? Once you're born, you're already on your way to dying. It's true.
Well, the clock started ticking, but...
Yeah, the clock's ticking, mate.
I like to look at it like this.
You need to pull your finger out, Stephen. Well, the clock's ticking, mate.
We're dying. Like, we're all dying, but... You know, when you're young, you're still growing. So when do you actually start the slow decline?
There's the science again.
When do you start it? Because when you're young, you regenerate
yourself.
It's just
a phrase, mate. It's just a phrase.
Well, you've kicked me off now, haven't you? What a horrible thing to say. Right. There's like 6-year-olds all over the world listening to this podcast.
Six-year-olds listen to this.
I know there isn't, but...
They're watching The Lion King, mate.
Well, there's a 2.5-year-old called Isaac, and he listens to it every week. I make sure.
It's because you make him.
I do. I put
it's
it
got
on
no choice.
It's when he's been... Hey. He gets put in the naughty corner, you go, right, listening to Daddy now. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't misbehave the rest of the day.
I bet you he doesn't.
No more podcast. So, no, the circle of life, Barry, to do with plants... And the circle of life starts with a seed. So, what to do with seeds? Do you have any top tips for seeds?
Loads of people do soak them in water enough. What is it, 24 hours in that buff?
The reason being is that seeds are in the dormant state and they need that water to wake them up. Yeah. They also, along with the water, they need heat. So people soak the harder to germinate seeds in water for 24 hours because they feel it gives them a better strike rate. I would probably tend to agree with them. Right. That soak them, it's just science.
Oh, yeah, I'm not saying
but you just
wrong.
Don't do it.
I just don't do it. It's, everyone's got their own little method. Some people will put them straight into a Rockwell or a Jiffy or whatever without soaking them.
Root riots, particularly.
Yeah,
good.
Root riots and that. Yeah, people will do that. Everyone's got their own little methods, haven't you? Do you know what I mean?
I'll see what your method is because actually.
My
don't
method
know.
Is it.
We'll talk about it later because I want to talk about your methods later.
Shut me down.
I do. Because I know you'll get carried away yourself, Barry. And I'm just trying to rein you in a little bit. Have you ever heard of this method, though, where you drop a seed into the water and it either sinks or it floats?
If it sinks,
it's viable.
Yeah,
and if it floats, it's a shithead. Or the other way around. But I don't know. Yeah. If you do know,
I've never soaked them, mate, so I wouldn't know.
Yeah, no.
What's that?
What is that? Can you hear that for a motorbike? Oh my god, that's a heavy motorbike, that isn't it? I feel like I'm in the Sons of Anarchy now. All we need is a big table knocker. You've just finished. You're nearly finished.
I'm going to take a fucking vote on him in a minute because I'm pissed off. Hey.
I think he's showing off to everyone, isn't he? So, yeah, so either they float or they sink. Now, if you've got experience of this and to work for you, I want to know what the people listening, if you've used that and on what your experience is. So please get in touch. Easiest way is direct message on Instagram at NPK_hydroponics and let me know what you've done. So that's the 24 hours in water. Next is the wet paper tissue method. It's the fail safe for me.
That's where I go.
Is that straight in? Straight seeds, bump done.
Bit of kitchen roll, a little tub away.
Is the important
wrap
question,
wrap it up in
nobody.
A towel, back of the air and cupboard, 2 days. Bam.
Is the big question, nobody. Serious one. So, how do you choose whether to use one of your sandwich packs? Because your food's very important to you. And I know it puts you into a bit of a mental quandary. Oh, do I sacrifice my sandwich packet or do I use it for my seeds? How do you get past it? How do you get past the sandwich or the survival of your seed?
Just don't use my sandwich bag, mate.
What do you use?
Tupperware box.
But that's still contained. That still holds food. So
yeah,
how do you get past that?
The food, mate. The food's well gone, lad. Hey.
And you've got empty Tupperware boxes.
Yeah, I've got loads of them, mate.
So do you use a Tupperware box, do you?
Little Tupperware box. Like 6 inch by 3 inch by about an inch.
Here's the builder coming out of you.
Yeah. You wouldn't know, mate.
I wouldn't know. We had a chat before about how I can't put wallpaper up and fucking hell, you made me feel shit for hours afterwards.
Yeah.
You're not a proper man if you can't wallpaper.
No, but you're not a proper man if you don't have a go.
Who said
to us before, yeah, my bed does all the wallpaper. And I thought, what do you do? The ironing while she's doing it or something?
Wasn't me before you all start. I am shit at wallpapering. I wouldn't even have a go because I know I'm shit at that sort of stuff.
When you have a go, mate,
there's no books on Amazon that
tell you
how to do wallpapering.
Three rooms deep, you might start getting good at it, mate. You'd be all right then.
Why do I need to be good at it when I've got you? And look, everyone thinks this is a real brick wall. Anyway, we're getting off the subject. Wet paper tissue method.
Boss.
I put it into, so what I do is kitchen towel, soaking in water, put the seeds on top, another piece of kitchen towel on top with water, put it into the sandwich bag and I put it, like you say, in the airing cupboard or wherever your boiler is. So it's warm, 23 degrees and dark as well. You don't need light to germinate. After 3 days, you should start to see your germination rate.
Well,
you should start to see the seeds popping out and then you put them into your soil or you put them into your jiffies, your rockwool or something like your root riots. Yeah. It's a fail-safe method because if they don't pop in the way paper tissue method, they're probably unlikely to pop, aren't they?
Yeah.
So I just...
You're being sold a dud.
Yeah. I'm going to actually talk about that later when people are... Actually, it's like one of my...
That plants fire and blanks.
I've got a point on that, actually. I'm going to skip to this point. Seed germination rate. I learned this yesterday, actually, out of one of my books.
I know it.
Do you? Because I told you about it before.
No, you haven't knew it anyway.
I'm just going to blow you off. You're going to read my shit. Go and tell me what you're going to say then.
Isn't it? If you want 100 seed...
Go on, yeah.
Why are you laughing?
Flag everyone that you fucking knew this one.
What?
Come on.
Listen, isn't it about if you want 100 cuttings, 100 plants?
Yeah.
You've got a pot, you've got to pop about 120.
Well, that's what it says on your piece of paper, yeah.
Does it? Yeah.
Yeah. Do you just know that off the top of your
head? Tell you that?
No.
You've been jotting down, haven't you?
I occasionally jot down. No, what I've written down is, you're right, though, Barry, seed germination. If germination is 90%, so what you do is you look at the back of the packet, and if it says seed germination is 90% successful and you need 100 plants, you will divide 100 by 90, and that gives you 1.11. So the 0.11 is your 11% extra you need. So you need 100 plants, so you'll need to get 111 seeds, which is the 11% extra, to make sure that you're going to get roughly 100 plants. And then some of those 90% won't be very good seedlings, so you'll add another 5% on top of that. So in total, it's 11% and 5%, 16. So for every 100 plants you need, you would try and go for 116 seeds.
Yeah, just stick to the 120, though.
Just four for good luck.
Yeah. You can just kick a few out.
Yeah. You love battering your plants, don't you? So if you're going for 10 plants, you do 16 seeds, or as Barry wants to do it, the magic extra four, you go for 20. But there's a little bit of a thing there. If these seeds are expensive, then you want to get the right mix of getting the amount of plants that you want and not spending too much money on excess seeds. So it's a good little method to use if you're into your seed grow. What is the best environment for your seeds and seedlings?
Once rooted.
To germinate.
To germinate.
It's like 100% moisture.
Like I said, I just do mine in the wet paper tissue in the thing. I just put my... what I do is I wrap it up in a towel so it's dark, and then I just put them to the back of the airing cupboard. And like you say, wait. And just wait. Within 2 or 3 days, make it through. If they're not through, there's a problem.
To pop them, it's like 100% humidity, as much moisture as possible. But you also want to get them out of the tissue quick, because get a little bit of rot or mold, can't you? So as soon as that taproot starts to pop out, that's when you want to get them out of there. So you're onto your seedlings popped. It's the first set of true leaves are not the first set of leaves. The first set of leaves are actually called the cotyledon. That's another word I can't say, but they're the set of leaves that break the shell open. That's not a proper part of the plant. Your first set of true leaves is the next set of leaves after that, and it started to develop a root system. What's the best environment now?
To be honest with you, Steve, I just put mine straight in jiffies, like 41 mil jiffies.
Yeah.
And go straight into a propagator with them.
Yeah. And what do you measure humidity in there, or do you just...
As long as it's between... it's probably going to kill me now, but as long as it's between 65 and 80, I'm half happy.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Just half happy. Are you 100% happy?
When it's sitting on 75, but it's fucking hard. You know what I mean?
For other people that aren't throwing temperature hygrometers in there, the mist on up at the top of the propagator is normally a good indicator that the humidity is pretty high.
Yeah.
Take the lid off, flick off the excess moisture, and allow it to rehumidify. And as long as you're seeing that, then you've got a pretty good chance of having good plants.
If I get seedlings that I've done myself, then as soon as I put them in the prop, I'll leave them in there without opening the lid for about 3 days, something like that. And then I'll open the lid and give the lid a good clean. I'll even take the jiffies back out,
see how much moisture they've got.
See how much moisture, but I'll also clean all the tray of all the stagnant water now, you know what I mean?
Brought me on to next point, which is, I think it's a good point that not many people focus on. And this environment that we need to use to grow seedlings and cuttings is also it's a very good environment for pests like fungus gnat. So top tips is keep your room clean. And if you do suffer with fungus gnats and things like this, you'll need to use a biological larvicide, and it's called Bacillus thuringiensis, and it kills the gnat larva. So
what?
Bacillus thuringiensis. It's a strain that fungus gnats don't really like because it kills them. So if you're in, it's mostly for people that are in rock walls. Oh, here she is. Oh, here's the team. Are we doing this late again? Here's the girl.
Hello.
She's jumped on. So if you haven't seen this member of the team, I'll put her on.
Oh, she's so wild. Get down.
Brian, why have you brought this dog in?
This is what we have to put up with.
Well, the dog's not the problem. It's Brian has thought it'd be a good idea to let her run riot.
Oh, it's only live. Everyone knows the dog.
Well, I actually put her up on Instagram before, so go and check that out if you haven't seen. But yeah, there's a few products with Bacillus thuringiensis, and that'll kill fungus and gnats. Now, here's a little top tip for you. You know, for the wet paper tissue method, you've soaked it for 24 hours and you've bought 5 seeds, one of them just isn't popping. Little top tip, you know, if you scratch the outside layer of the seed on like an emery board, you know what women use to file the nails down? Scratch the outside of that, put it back into water for a few hours, then put it into a wet paper tissue method. That is usually can work for popping your seeds. So it's a little top tip for you, scratch your seeds.
Yeah, because don't they put a coating on them?
Sometimes, yeah. Or the seed itself develops a coating because it thinks it needs to last a bit longer outside. Now, if you need to store your seeds somewhere cold and dark,
you need to take them to that place. What's it called? It's built in the mountain.
Cornwall or somewhere.
No, mate. Have you seen the proper seed place, what they've got?
I have. There's a vault. It's the vault.
And it's got
London.
It's not.
Isn't it the Eden? Nah, not the Eden Project. It's in the big gardens.
Someone Google it dead quick. It's somewhere and it's built into the side of a mountain.
Yeah.
And it's like a proper vault and it's got every kind of seed you can think of. Every plant that is on this planet, they have got that seed stored in there in case there's ever an emergency.
What do you mean?
That we've run out of cabbage or something.
We've got no cabbage.
Beetroot goes fucking, I don't know. Beetroot disappears.
Well, the beetroot epidemic. Yeah, beetroot, every cyclist in the country started drinking it. We've run out. We need more seeds.
There is doctors who find that.
Find out what vault that is and we'll mention it. Just if you need to store them somewhere cold, 7 degrees in your fridge, and make sure it's dark as well. Make sure they're dry as well. If you're saving seeds, make sure they're dry, cold, and dark. Right, Cody's passed me his phone, and apparently it's Svalbard Global Seed Vault, and that's one of them.
Where
definitely.
Is it?
Svalbard.
Where's that?
I'm going to say Norway. I think it's in Norway. Spitsbergen it is, and it cost 45 million. It was opened on the 26th of February 2008.
Told you.
But there is one in the UK. Don't find the one in the UK for me, Coates. There's definitely one in there. That's seeds, pretty much. They're pretty simple to get going. If you haven't been able to get them going, then we'll give you some top tips there. It's onto cuttings. This, I think, is the majority of people that are growing plants try and take them from cuttings, because I had the hottest chili pepper in the world, and getting it to germinate was pretty difficult. So once I got it to germinate and I found the plant that was hardy and gave me a lot of fruit, I didn't want to risk germinating more seeds and finding out what was going on. So I took a cutting of that plant, and now I've got plenty of cuttings of this Carolina Reaper, and I know what I'm getting time in, time again. Do you know what I mean? So here's a few things with cuttings. It's called... So you're just going to have to pause that there for a second, bro. The proper echoes on the mic, you know, when you let her in, bro. Is she out? Pull her out the room for us, please, Brian.
Get out, bastard. Maya. Out.
Put her in the kitchen with a few boxes. In out. Front of her.
Pain in the ass. Fucking shit up here.
Ready to go again, Coach? So there's a theory with cuttings, Barry, and I call it the top, middle, bottom theory. Do you know what I'm on about? The top, middle, bottom theory. I'm sure we've talked about it before. I know you do know about it. I'm going to remind you. Take cuttings from the top of the plant that are closest to the light.
Oh, I know all this. Yeah, maybe I just didn't say it properly.
What's the top, middle, bottom theory? I'm going to call it TMB, the TMB theory.
I know what it is.
There
now,
we go. Yeah. I didn't invent it.
If you take a cutting from the top of a plant, it'll root quicker.
Quickly? It'll root quickly?
Root quickly.
These are Scottish cuttings. It'll root dead quickly.
Fucking hell, man.
Go on.
It'll root quicker,
yeah,
but it won't be as strong.
Yeah.
If you take a cutting from the bottom of a plant, which is being fighting its way for light, it'll take longer to root, but it'll be a stronger plant.
So,
and if you take one from the middle, you're just playing
a little bit
safe.
Best of both worlds. Yeah. So I go for the middle of the plant when I'm taking cuttings. Equipment for taking cuttings: scalpel, a rooting hormone, but I'm just going to say Clonex because it's the most widely used rooting hormone in the world and it's the best. So it's Clonex. A little bit of Clonex mist, not necessary, but works wonders for, yeah, for your cuttings.
Yeah, there is other ones out there, but that
you need good. A propagator, Jiffies, Rockwells, and Root Whites. There you go.
Whichever one of your choice.
Exactly.
What you only need one, you don't need all three. I use Jiffies.
Do you?
I use Jiffies, mate.
Root Riots, I tend to do quite well in Root Riots. Yeah. And that's not to say that Rockwools don't work, because if I'm honest, Jiffies, Rockwools, and Root Wyatt,
Root Wyatt.
We have Jonathan Watts on the show, and he's with Root Wyatt. Tit. Jiffies, Rockwools, and Root Riots, in my opinion, all work equally well.
Yeah.
But some will dry out quicker, so are better for a grower that
looks
over feed. Yeah, yeah. Some will stay moist for longer. Yeah, yeah. So if you can't be there, then that's better for you. You could find out if you're new to it, take some cuttings and put them in
one of each.
If you're
new to it, I'd definitely say go with Jiffies.
Yeah,
it's a bit more fail safe. Wet a little bit longer. If you're hands on constantly with them, I'd say go with
Rockwools. But Root Riots are a nice mix.
Root Riots are right in the middle. I think they're right in the middle between Jiffies and Rockwools.
I love this head movement.
Yeah,
you do.
Baby. You can feel me knocking. Let me in.
Left to right. Root Riots are a little bit in the middle, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
So you've got best of both ways, but they are expensive and compared to Jiffies and Rockwools. Jiffies and Rockwools, you can pick up for like 10 pence each.
Come on for you, Steve.
It's right by, we're right by the women's hospital, aren't we, in Liverpool. Yeah. There's another child being born.
That's a seedling.
There's another child on its way to fucking the countdown to death, as Barry puts
it. Take cuttings off it.
Use what works for you. If you're new to it, do something in each of them and see which comes out the best, because that'll be the best one for you.
It's what works for you.
Scalpels, buy a new one every time you come to do it, or sterilise your scalpels. Always make sure you've got clean utensils. How do you take your cuttings, Barry? And then I'll say,
off a plant.
That is a good start. Yeah, yeah. It's a good start to take them off a plant. Yeah. Any particular technique?
No, it's the same as everyone else, mate. It all works.
Whap into the Clonex, bung into it into
I
the
grab it, snap
jiffy,
it off.
Grab it, snap it off. Some rusty old scissors.
I put it in the Clonex.
If I haven't got Clonex, I'll roll it in some spit and then bung it in a jiffy. Away you go.
It actually does work.
Over the Christmas period, we ran out of Clonex and we would tell everyone, spit on your jiffies. We got a few weird looks, but at least we got through the Christmas. So if you want to get technical, then I would take a cutting at 45 degrees.
Yeah.
One, because it increases surface area, and I'll make sure any of the, we call them juices, do run off and then not staying on the plant, so you're not attracting disease or pest. Then, if you take the scalpel and take out, it's called the epidermis. That's a nice word for you. The outer layer of the plant. Just scratch all the way around. Again, increase the surface area. It's probably going to improve your strike rate. Dip it in your Clonex. Do not dip your cotton into the Clonex tub. Apparently, it can mix and contaminate and put it off. So pour what you need into a little glass vial, a little shot glass, but don't drink it. Use that, and then once it's done and you've done all your cuttings, throw it away. Yeah. Don't put it back in the tub.
Cheap enough to buy Clonex.
Yeah, it is. It's only like five for a small tub.
Yeah.
And then just put it into what you're putting it into. Put it into your Rockwools, your Jiffies, or your Root Whites, or anything that you happen to use for taking your cuttings. What to put it in and the best environment for cuttings? I'll go for this. 75% humidity and 23 to 24 degrees Celsius. With a little bit, if you're not in a propagator and you've started to harden them off, a little bit of air movement around it, not too much. You don't want that transpiration too high, so they lose loads of moisture. But you also don't want no air movement and just go stagnant and they haven't got a replenished supply of CO2. Just a little bit of airflow and it'll start toughening up the stem, making the stem a bit bigger as well. So there's things for cuttings. Anything to add with cuttings? Is there anything special that you do? Or just keep it basic and do the same thing time and time again?
I just keep it basic. Does it work? It just works. I trim the leaf back.
Do you trim the leaf back?
Yeah, I do trim the leaf back.
Is that just so you've got extra space in there? To be honest, there's a few reasons.
It's extra space and...
Yeah. They lose less water, don't they?
Yeah.
There's two reasons for it. One is like use it for, so you can get more in the propagator rather than loads of taking up space. The other thing is, like, transpiration rate is the most important things with cuttings. So if you've got a big leaf, you're going to lose a lot of water to the environment. So if you trim that in half, it's less leaf to lose water. Yeah. As long as you keep the main new buds intact, that's what's going to grow. And that's why you, it could be worth trimming off some of them leaves for you. What products do you particularly use for early development? Like, what's the best for vegetative growth? So we've got the seedling, or you've got your cutting, you've got roots on them, you're starting to harden them off. So that means harden them off means taking the propagator lid off for an hour.
Opening the vents.
Yeah, opening the vents and just like starting that. To acclimatise them to the big, bad environment of your grow room. Do you have any favourite products or go-to products? That they're not necessary, but they can help.
Overgrow.
Optic folia,
foliar feed.
Yeah.
Like a bit of that, like a little bit of Formulex to feed them with.
Okay. Why optic folia? Have you just found that to be one of your...
It's a boss product because you can spray it with the lights on.
But what is it a good product, or is it the fact you can spray it with the lights on?
It's a good product.
Yeah.
They do that 24-hour challenge, don't they? And you can see it works. There's something about it. It does work. Yeah. You know what I mean?
And it's just an added benefit that you can spray it with the lights on. It's not going to burn.
It's cheap, which is what everyone wants. No one wants to pay hundreds of pounds just for a foliar spray. It's cheap, it works, and you can spray it with the lights on.
Okay. I agree with you. I like optic foliar. Another one's Plant Magic Evolution. A really good. It's dark liquid. You can spray it straight onto the plants. You can't spray it with the lights on. So for me, I just give it to optic foliar. I give optic foliar edge because you can carry on using it in veg with the high intensity dish, the HID lights on, and you're not going to burn your plants. It's a big advantage for people. Who goes into the room in the dark and sprays the
plants?
This
is like another podcast that you need to hit on because there's that many foliar sprays.
You just need to do
there.
A foliar spray.
There shouldn't
podcast,
be.
Don't we?
A foliar spray on the market now that you can't spray while the lights are on.
I think it's pretty innovative technology. But you know then again, optic foliar do transport, don't they? So you could just, you've got to be careful because you can add transport to any foliar to allow it to be sprayed with the lights on.
But all these other foliar companies, I know we're going off the subject, but all these other foliar feed, people who make foliar feeds now.
They should
be doing it. Because how many people go to the grow room or go in the grow room when the lights are off?
And spats
to start falling over everything and spraying the plants. People want to do it when the lights are on.
Yeah.
Don't see the point.
Is that the reason why foliar feed's not a big thing in the UK?
Yeah,
because you just don't go there.
No one goes there, do
they? It's not because we're lazy.
It's not that we're lazy. It's just that you just don't go in your grow room when it's pitch black, do you? Yeah. Start letting light leakage get in there. And then you're going around with an edge torch and trying to step over things. And then you don't know. As well, you've only got a little head torch on or whatever you've got on. You might have turned that light on for a minute, but you're not. It's like a rush job.
Yeah.
Where if you do it when the lights are on, it's not so much of a rush job now. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Come closer into that microphone, buddy, because you're getting dead comfy and you're making me all sleepy.
But I just don't see that there's just no room in this industry for products that you can't spray with.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Everything should be sprayable when the lights are on now.
Okay. Good. The other thing is that I've never really thought about is spraying. With the lights off, the humidity is already could be higher than it is with the lights on. And you don't want to, if you're in flower or you're in the early vegetative stage, you're in the early flowering stages, if you're spraying, you're increasing your humidity, you're increasing the chances of molds and that sort of stuff, aren't you? So, our winner for foliar is optic foliar.
Yeah.
I love using mycorrhizae and beneficial bacteria. So, personally, my favorite is Extreme Gardens Azos. It's a nitrogen fixing bacteria. So if your young plants, you're not giving them too much feed, they can absorb nitrogen. The bacteria can turn the N2 in the environment into an available form of nitrogen for the plants. It helps with transplant shock. You've also got Great White, which is a good all-round. It's got many different beneficial bacteria, and you can use quite a few.
I like Charge.
Charge is a good one. Insect Frass, you mix in an Orgy Cocoa, gives you good results. So there's another beneficial bacteria that's good to use. What else have we got? So Great White, Azos, and Biosis. Biosis is a good one, not specific for the early stages. You can use it pretty much all the way through, but Biosis has got a good range of beneficials in there that helps with transplant shock.
What about Bactivita? I've known people to put Bactivita on them.
Well, Bactivita is hydrotops, isn't it? Use it all the way through. I love Bactivita. I've got very little bad to say about Bactivita, but you know on it on Azos and Great White, I know what's in them. You know, with Bactivita and Top Heavy Crop and Triple F, I haven't got a clue what's in them. So I personally like to know what bacteria strains are in there. And they've kept it a little bit of a secret, haven't they? So no one copies them, but I personally like to know what's in them. But yeah, good product, and you can use it in the beginning. There's a product by CX I've just started using the last 6 months called Clone Start. Yeah. It's a foliar spray again. It's
direct out the bottle, isn't
but
it?
But it's specifically for clones.
Yeah.
It really does help with strike rate. You spray Clone Start on even before they've got roots. The CX range is just a good range anyway. And this Clone Start helps your strike rates a lot. Now, moving on from the products, cuttings and seeds, I want to talk about the science. Why do we do all this stuff? Barry, at the end of the podcast, you've got your grower's minute. And that is to basically slam me and say, you don't really need to do it all. I'm going to let you have your minute, so let me have mine. The science of young plants and why do we do all of the above? This is my top tip. I was going to say at the end of the podcast, but propagation, cuttings, seedlings, it's all about humidity. The reason it's all about humidity is because of transpiration rates. Your young plant doesn't have the root system to uptake the water that it needs to survive. If at the same time, it's losing a lot of water to the environment, and it loses a lot of water when your humidity is low. When you've got a high humidity of 70, 80, 90%, then it doesn't lose so much. So there's less stress on the roots to be able to uptake water and continue its life and try and grow more roots. And what's linked to transpiration rates, and we're going to do a specific podcast on this year, VPD. Now we're going to do a whole podcast on VPD. It's vapor pressure deficit. It's something that we really need to drill home for 2019. Vapor pressure deficit it's in the name. It's the vapor pressure in the air compared to inside the plant. And I've got a lovely little chart on my phone. I'm going to throw up on our Facebook tomorrow. I'll do it on Monday morning, the day after the podcast. It's got blue lines for low transpiration, which is your early veg. It's got green lines for your healthy transpiration and vegetative phase. And it's got an orange phase, which is for your high transpiration flowering. And then any of the red parts is warning, like it's too high or it's too low. So if I give you an example, if your room in early veg, which is cuttings and seedlings, you want to go for the blue sector. And so if your temperature in degrees Celsius is 23, then you need a humidity of 80 to 70%. And that's a good humidity range for 23 degrees Celsius. If you have a humidity range of 23 degrees of 37.5%, that's when you're getting to get into trouble and the plant's going to transpire too much. Yeah. To be able to keep up with the amount of water the plant, the roots need to take up. So that's VPD. We're going to talk about it much more in depth, but start looking into it now so that when we do the podcast, you've got an idea of what you're looking at, and it's going to become a big thing. And it's already massive in the US.
You've well had over a minute there, you know, mate.
Oh, I said you could have a minute. I get extra because I know that you can go on with yourself.
Can I see your chart? Get your chart back up for when my minute comes, mate.
Yeah, of course it can. There's my chart. There's my VPD chart.
Yeah.
There you go.
VPD.
Two things that I'm going to talk about just before Barry gets his grower's minute. Keep lights close to your plants to prevent stretching, but not too close so that it burns them. But if you have your lights too far away, then they can stretch, they become spindly, and there's no structure there to support a healthy plant at the end of flowering. And then listen to this, Barry. Have you heard of this? When the plants are young, a slightly higher EC than you'd normally give them can slow vegetative growth and create sturdier plants. That's something I've read.
What's that?
A slightly higher EC, so brand new cuttings with a slightly developed root system, you might give them on an EC pen 0.8 to 1.
Yeah.
So what this is saying is if you give them a slightly higher EC, then it slows vegetative growth, which means that they stretch less and create sturdier plants. Now, I've not tested it myself. I've not seen it. I think I've heard a few people.
Where's that come from?
It's come from Howard Resch's hydroponic food production. He's a big player in hydroponic food production. So one of the techniques that he uses, if you need to either slow down the vegetative growth or if they are stretching, he said you can feed them a bit more and it'll stop the stretch. Because some people say if you feed them water too much, then they can stretch for some reason. I don't know the reasons for that. That's a bit of research for me to do this week. But if anyone's got any experience with that, let us know. I'm actually really interested in that. So they're my few top tips for when the science of growing young plants. Grower's minute. What really matters, Barry?
It's not a grower's minute, mate. Read that back out. My eyes are terrible. Read that back out. So the temperature so is, in my room, yeah. The temperature in my room now is 23. And I'm in early veg.
And you're in early veg. So you'd like to, you should be aiming for a humidity of between 80% and 70%.
Yeah. And that's, but to get to that 80% and 70%, I've got to have some technical shit in there, mate.
A humidifier?
I've got to have a humidifier. I've got to have some sort of good controllers on me fans, me intakes, me outtakes. Mm. It's when I say it's big money, it's not massive money, but some people can't afford it.
Okay.
Some people are in the basics, mate. So all you can do is do your best. You're not going to kill your plant by not giving it the humidity that it really needs off a chart. Mm. What you're going to do is just, your plant's just going to take a little bit longer.
Yeah.
It's going to adapt to that situation. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's not, by not sticking to the chart doesn't mean that you're not going to get results at the end of it. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's great if you can afford all these big EC fans now and the big controller that controls the humidifier, the air in, the air out, knocks lights off, turns lights on. That's fantastic if you've got that.
You've got the best chance.
If you've got the best chance, you should get a success rate. If you don't, mate, I'll be very disappointed.
Yeah.
Because that's what it is. You're now not the grower. Yeah. That machine's growing it for you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Some people who haven't got that money and haven't got that room, and you're still going to get you still are going to be able to grow.
It could just
put an extra week on things.
Yeah.
But it is what it is, and it is what it is, and that's it. You've just got to stick, you know, if you can't afford all these big high powered things and
just
do your best with it. Try and improve it other ways. And do you know what I mean?
Like there is cheap, easy methods of improving your humidity. Wet towels just hung up on the wall can help a little bit. Just have a little research or fire in some messages saying, listen, I'm not able to get that big.
I'm not in a position to get that.
So what can I use? And there's plenty of methods that you can use without spending hundreds of pounds. Coatsy, how long's our podcast been? Because there's something that I want to get into, Barry, but if we're over an hour, then we'll discuss it on another podcast.
Don't tell me, no, you can't leave me like that.
Oh, I'll leave all the growers like that. It's a good, interesting
just
topic.
Lie, coach. What is it?
40 minutes? 42?
Yeah, we're all
right. Sound laughing.
Get into it.
This is me and Barry now. This is full-on discussion. When me and Barry talk about humidity.
I thought you were going to say, is the whale flat all around?
We're not even going to talk about that, mate. Why, maybe one day, but no. And by the way, listeners, we both believe the world is round. Yeah. Or an oblate spheroid, as I like to call it. like an oversized donut.
Cool.
So, me and Barry, we have not a difference of opinion, because I agree with you, but it's good to discuss this part. Humidity in young plants, we know it's important, don't we? We can agree. Everything we've talked about is correct. Yeah. But Barry's got a theory, and the theory is correct. And what is your theory, Barry?
You tell him yours first.
So my theory is that Coatsy's train is at 1834.
It's just written notes.
It's currently 5:58. So we have to wrap this up in 5 minutes, Barry.
So
my theory is that you start them off with, you follow VPD, you put them in the propagator, you harden them off slowly, you open the vents, you take it off for an hour. Next day, you may take it off for four hours and try and put it back on. This is an ideal build if you can. You want to harden them off slowly. And in a nutshell, your philosophy is that, correct, put them in propagation, but then once they're ready or they hit propagation, take the lid off, put them in the pot and just put them in the room.
I'll harden them off a bit, but I just don't understand these people who... And it works for them. It is what it is. What works for me works for me, and what works for them works for them. But I think you can baby something too much too long.
Yeah.
These people, they propagate it for ages. They'll crack the lid and they'll do what they're doing. Then they'll take it out and they'll put it in a 15-litre pot. Then they'll put the dome on it.
Yeah.
What's that all about, mate?
So I'm one of those people that will put...
You are one of those people. I think you're here to stay. And that's that, mate. I'm not babying you. You're going to have to harden yourself up and adapt to this situation.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So the situation of whatever the situation is.
You've been in that propagator, you've had no roots. Now you've got roots. I'm going to harden you off by opening the vents, taking the propagator lid off every day, giving it a clean, open the vents fully to the point where I'll leave the propagator lid off for a couple of hours. Then I'll put it back on with the vents open. The next day I'll leave it off for a few more hours. Then I'll take it fully off for a day and leave it and see what they do, see if they start to droop or whether they like it or whether they don't. And once that's done and I'm happy that they're happy there now, then it's straight in the pot, mate.
Yeah.
If you don't like it,
So
knock it on the head.
What about putting a humidifier in there?
Yeah, you can put humidifier.
Do you think you're going over the top a
No, you're all right, but I just don't understand. I just think you can mudder something too long. It's like these, some mums will wrap their kids up in cotton wool, won't they?
Yeah.
When you were kids, you know, if you dropped a sweet on the floor, what would you do?
Eat it, a sweet.
You pick it up, it had the 10-second rule, didn't it?
Yeah, I didn't get
but
that.
Where then. I came from, it had the 20-second rule.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I didn't get sick when I was a kid in that. And that was because I probably had sweets off the floor. My own sweets were aboard, don't get me wrong. I don't want it to sound like that. But some people will wrap their kids up in cotton wool and the kids constantly got a snotty nose, constantly at the walk-in centres and the doctors and the hospitals because they haven't let that kid adapt to the world. I just look at plants like they're the same. They're just like us. And I think to myself, put your plant in there, mate. If it doesn't like it,
it is what it is.
It is what it is. It'll have to fucking harden itself up and get on with it.
I agree. But if I can, if I've got access to a humidifier or...
Oh, I'm not saying that don't put a humidifier in there, but it's like I said before, for the people out there who can't afford all that big fancy equipment and all stuff like that, put a humidifier in there. And if you bring it up a little bit, you bring it up a little bit, fantastic. But I just don't believe in going in and putting domes over plants that are in 15-litre pots that, and the plant's 6 inches tall. And I just think, fucking hell, mate, is that how shit your strain is?
Yeah.
Come on, lad.
So the reason that like people could baby them is if you want to give your genetic the best chance possible, then it all comes down to stomata. And if you've got, so if you're in a room where it's a little bit drier than it should be, then the plant won't produce as many stomata as it could do because it's thinking to itself.
I fully understand. Yeah. I fully understand it all. I fully understand it. And I know
you don't explain to
a plant with high humidity has got a better chance
of reaching its genetic potential.
Yeah. But it is what it is.
No,
that's just me. Just me. Yeah, it is what it is.
Well, the reason for that, and we've had the conversation. I know you know, but it basically comes down to the amount of stomata on the underside of the leaf. The plant will produce more if it's in its perfect environment. But I understand what you're saying. Sometimes you just can't give it the perfect environment. If you've got access to domes, throw them on because it can't help. But I also do agree with Barry. You don't go over the top with this shit because you can't do it too much. And all of a sudden, you're going to have to take that dome off one day.
And then now you've got...
Nah, they're knackered.
Yeah.
Here's the point where you come in really, like, this is where Barry's point's really important. If you're mothering your plant for the first 3 weeks and giving it the best environment, and then something happens in your room which makes it go really dry, your plant's going to be really, they're going to fail.
They're going to fucking punish you.
Because they're used to the Laboutins, the Canada Gooses, the fancy restaurants. Yeah. Suddenly you start taking it to Mackey's. That's like, what the fuck's this, mate?
Fuck you, mate.
Yeah, I'm getting off. Yeah. That's what your plants are doing.
She's like a supermodel, lad.
If you start...
don't buy a Laboutins and Gucci handbags and all that, she's just going to think, fuck you, mate, I'm off, lad.
So if your plants have been brought up and in a perfect environment, and then for some reason something happens and your environment has gone downhill a little bit, and there's nothing you can do about it, the plants will punish you. If you do harden them off a little bit early on and adjust it to the environment that it's going to be in, then you've got a better chance of having a healthier plant throughout veg and into flower.
But I do fully agree with all the humidities and everything like that. I know how it works. But me personally, I just think, nah, I've got to harden them up. They've got to be hard because one day something could happen. And
you want your plants to be hard.
One day you might not be in. Your allotment and the temperatures can drop and you haven't got time to put that heater on or whatever it is. And at least you've got more of a fighting chance that...
If you've hardened them off.
If you've hardened them off a bit, they'll deal with it a little bit more.
If you think you can't be with your plants as much as you want to be, then it's going to be better to harden them off a little bit earlier. Not give them a perfect environment. But if you can afford to be with them every day and
you've got the best of stuff,
then always give them the best.
Always give them the best environment. But if you haven't, don't worry.
Sound. Finish up with a top tip. Mine is, humidity is the most important aspect for young plants because of transpiration. It is literally the be all and end all. What was yours? You told me before.
What was it?
Overwater and underwater.
Overwater and underwater. It is, though.
Yeah, don't overwater. It is, though.
Constantly in the shop, they come in and go, oh, look, I've got this tree. I've put my plants out. Because your plant, they say 4 inches, 5 inches. I say, yeah, what size pot's it in? They say, 20 litre. And straight away, my head goes anyway. I think, wow. So how many are you feeding it? They say, give it like 2 litres the other day. And I think, fucking no.
Yeah.
You plant 2 litres of water and it's only that big. Wow.
Yeah, it hasn't got the straws to suck it up.
Yeah, it hasn't. The plant's got no waste. That plant putting 2 litres, lad.
Yeah.
Oh, mate, use your head.
Because 90% of what it takes up, it transpires. If you give it too much, you just can't physically get rid of it.
And then it's just sitting there still. So overwater and underwater.
Get it right, just in the middle. Yeah. And when they're young and they have got that root system to take up, you also mentioned before, you have great ideas. You forget to bring them up. Just get a good foliar feed into them.
Yeah, good foliar feed.
That's how you're going to get most nutrition into them.
One that you can spray with the lights on. There's no room for the others.
Nah.
Change your ways.
They've worked up until now, but now that the technology's
now
there,
times change.
Let's get everybody's foliar spray with the lights on. Sorry, Optic, you've set the trend. Yeah. Everyone needs to follow.
You've set the standards, mate, and that's it.
Well, that's it.
Just in a nutshell. Let's just put it to bed because it does do me head in that, you know.
Go on.
How much of other products, we won't name them.
Yeah.
What sells the best in the shop for foliar?
Optic foliar.
Optic foliar.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Why?
Because you can spray it with the lights on.
Exactly, lad. Come on, mate. All sort your shit out with this.
Yeah, and it works well. Yeah, and it's a good product.
It's a Bosch product, and you can spray it when the lights are on when people are actually in the grow rooms.
Yeah. And it also, as a secondary, increases humidity.
Yeah, yeah.
Dead quick. Yeah. So you're willing there anyway. It's a good all-round product. Right, links and what we're talking about next week. Facebook, follow us on NPK Hydroponics Live if you want to watch the podcast, and NPK Technology for our shop shit, see what we're up to in the shop. Instagram, it's my favorite platform. I'm on it every day. You can, if you want quick replies, get me on there at NPK_hydroponics. Barry's going to curse me now, but follow Barry at Barry_NPK.
I'm not that
But he's not that active on it.
I'm not that active.
YouTube channel is the NPK Show, and our website is www.npktechnology.co.uk. Anything we've talked about, you can get on the website as well. Or phone us on 151-228-8306. It's probably the last time I'll do all that for the rest of the year. It pisses me off having to say all that. next week is the state of the hydroponics industry.
Oh, I can't wait for this.
What are we going to talk about? Like, Barry's getting excited.
Watch.
Oh, dear.
Can we just stay and do it now?
No. Coach has got a train to catch. We've got to go. Thank you, everybody that's listened. We are over the moon to be back for 2019.
Yeah, man.
We didn't go live this week on Facebook because the BT is shit and they're taking 2 weeks to upgrade that internet. I'm not about to start.
And we've still got work on
videos.
The podcast room. We can hear motorbikes, people giving beer.
Oh, yeah. We've got a little bit of adjusting to do to make perfection, but obviously we'll always try and improve it. And thank you once again to all of the partners: CANNA, AutoPot, Can Filters, SANlight, Revolution Microelectronics,
and most importantly, the listeners.
The listeners, you are the most important thing. Yeah. The reason
above
why
everyone.
We do everything. Thank you very much. We will see you next week.
Yeah, man.
Get your messages in if you want to talk about what's been going on in the hydroponics industry. Coatsy, see you out, bro.
Yeah, man.
See you later. Bye-bye. 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 Bye-bye.